Has anyone started practicing or not doing, getting a little bit of idea of how we are exploiting this?
I practice, sir. I practice the last concept with that AMI you sent via in chat, sir. But virtual box.
Right.
I did it from my friend.
So, like your system is properly
No, I did it
set up
from
now,
my friend's
Ruby 2.
laptop. I did it from my friend's
Okay.
laptop who stays beside my home. Actually, my personal laptop totally down, sir. I will make sure. I can practice with my friend's laptop.
So far, are you able to follow with whatever we are doing then?
Yes, sir.
Is it?
To do those.
Yeah.
Whatever techniques you have seen so far.
Yes, sir.
Like there's no issue on that end.
Yeah, the steps and process are a bit clear, yeah.
So are you guys able to follow whatever I'm talking about in class, or are there any doubts in that regard? Any questions?
Sir, just one request, sir. Sir,
Yeah.
actually, okay, it's practical, we can do, but to remember the steps, we need some.
Your voice is breaking off in the middle. I'm not able to. When you're saying I'm hearing, I'm only able to hear a part of what you're saying.
Hello, sir. Now is it clear, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, actually, I mean, okay, practicals we can do, sir. But one request, sir. So to follow steps to remember, we need some steps like sir, written, like first do this. Like, is it possible to get, sir? So, or we can get if we get the recording sessions immediately after the session, it might be possible. So to remember to do this, okay, we can write also write down while you are taking the class. But is it possible to have text, at least not theory, not theory explanation, total paragraph, just steps, first click here, do this like that.
You can get the recording, that's not an issue.
Okay, sir.
So just let me open up my system and we'll continue. So the other day we had looked at exploiting a vulnerability in FTP, the FTP service that was running. Now, so what I did was I saved a copy of a Metasploitable scan. Let's see the results. So the vulnerability scan, I saved the results in a text file. And basically what this does is it helps us save some time, so we don't have to wait. We don't have to wait every time for the scan to happen. So this is also a very useful functionality that you can save your scan results as text files. And even if a tool does not have this kind of thing, you can always redirect the tool's output to a text file if you want to save it. Now, what we did earlier was we exploited this FTP vulnerability. Now, we are going to look at something else. So we have a lot of results here that we can see, but not all of these will be useful to us. Now, Metasploitable also has a web interface. So port 80 is open and HTTP protocol is being used. Okay, so all the details about whatever URL was found on page, sorry, not page, on port 80, that have been mentioned here. Now, see, if I just open the browser, this was just for 1,000 most common ports. What we can also do is run a similar scan for all ports, but even that is going to take more time. Let's just run a scan, see what we get. Okay, I'll just now whenever you see that port 80 is open in any system, that means that there is a web server which you can connect to. So so see, there is a web interface that is available for Metasploitable 2. So if there is something running on port 80, that means there is probably a web server there that you can access. And it has a lot of different vulnerable websites in it. Okay, there's DBWA, there's Utility Web DAV. So again, this comes under web penetration testing, so we're not really going to get into this. But if there is something on port 80, it always helps to check it out, to check what application is being run there. Okay, the other day I asked you to try and look for this vulnerability, the FTP one, and see how you can exploit it without using Metasploit. So did anyone try that?
No.
No, sir.
Okay. Do try that once, you know. You have Metasploit on your system, you can simply scan it, you know, get the result of the vulnerable source, get this name, and using this information, you can look for this vulnerability. It's also giving you the CVE ID, which is the common vulnerabilities and exposures ID, or the CVE database. It actually is a database containing every vulnerability that is discovered and reported. So you even have the CVE ID here that is also useful while searching for information regarding any vulnerability that exists. So if you have the CVE number for it, you can easily search for it. So try to do this again. You know, it's not like this is the only and now I mentioned that there are more than one ways to hack into a system. Now there might be more than one way, and in Metasploitable, there's definitely a lot of ways to do this. So for now, let me just try running a service version detection scan for this IP. And don't just go based on the information that I'm running in the scans here. Run these scans yourself. See the information that you get. Because, like I mentioned previously, Nmap is one of the most important tools that we see here. So you must be, you know, you must be having practice with Nmap. So try to use it as much as possible, so that you get familiar with the different commands, the different switches in Nmap, the different options that you have, and that you know what kind of result you will get based on the kind of scan that you run. These things sometimes take longer than they should. now these are the excuse me, now these are the services running on the system. So now again, there are a lot of these things, but there are two in particular that are more interesting to us. Now there is something known as R login when we talk about protocols. So that's basically a remote login tool, and it was it's a legacy tool, you could say. So it was an old tool which allows a user to log in into a system. Now we see that it is running on these ports 512, 13, and 14. Let's try that R login, and the username, let's try to log in as root on the system, because we may not know other users, but we know that root definitely exists on the system. Okay, now using this, we were simply able to log in as root on the other system. No password required, nothing. So on the Metasploitable machine, on that system, I'm now logged in as root. If I perform a check, who am I in root? And of course, we know that because of this string here. It says root at the rate Metasploitable. Now, the thing is, when you get a lot of these services, when you get a lot of things running in this in any system that you scan, then the first thing to do is take a look at the services that you know. And if there is anything that you don't know, then you can search for it. Now, okay. If I take a further look at the results here, there's something known as Metasploitable root shell on port 1524. And it's simply, the service name is bind shell, and the version description says it's a Metasploitable root shell. So this is interesting, because if you're directly getting a root shell, that is, now can anyone tell me how can I connect to this? So I've closed my earlier connection. Can anyone tell me how I can connect to this? It's okay if you don't know, we are here to see what to do, but if you have an idea, please try to give the answer.
You mean how to connect via bind shell, sir?
Okay. See, there is a tool called Netcat. And I talked about this in an earlier session. So Netcat is a tool that you can use to open connections and to access an open connection to connect to a system over a network. So if I see that there is an open port and I want to connect to it. Now see, this is port 1524 and it's a root shell. Now this is not a website, it's not a web server, so I cannot use a browser here. Then it's not accessible via a browser. And there is no service like SSH or FTP which is running. So I cannot use those protocols to connect either. So what I do is I use Netcat to open a connection. Now the first thing I need to specify is Netcat NC. So the command for Netcat. After NC, I need the IP. So I know the IP is 10.0.2.252. And after that, I need the port number. So the port number in this case is, I think it was 1524. Yeah. So 1524 is the port number. So I pressed enter and now I'm connected to that port and we again have root access to the device. Now, normally, of course, you're not going to be facing a situation where you will directly be able to access a shell using a netcat connection. You'll have to work for it. But since this is Metasploitable, it's just for practice purposes. So they have provided this shell that you can simply connect to using a tool like Netcat. So we looked at our results and we connected. So this is another way that we have discovered for getting access, or you could say getting root access to a system.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Others, what other service should I target? Okay, so there are other things as well. There is another FTP server running known as Pro FTPD 1.3.1. Let us see whether we can exploit this. So I'll come out of this shell currently. For Metasploitable, okay, there is nothing for us to do on this system currently. So once we have root access, that's all we are going for. In other systems, however, when I move to other machines, our task will be, after getting shell on the machine, our task will be to get the flags present there. Okay, so in Metasploitable, let's search for this Pro FTPD as well. Now we have a few results here for the Pro FTPD service as well. But there is no guarantee that we'll be able to exploit it. Y, the version of OFTPD that Meta is running. That is 1.3.1, but in this case, okay, there is nothing for 1.3.1. Okay, the version that we saw here, this was 1.3.1. But we're not finding anything for it here. Okay, this is 1.3.2, 1.2 to 1.3, 1.3.2, 3.5, but nothing for 1.3.1. So let's just try a different approach. So, okay, not use FTP login. I think I should have used search. Okay, anyway, let's try to do this FTP authentication. And basically, the thing we'll be doing here is, we are trying a dictionary attack, similar to what we tried for SSH earlier, that we give it a word list or a dictionary file and it tries the values from there. And it will use those values to try and log into the system. Now, the options, the parameters that we need to pass it are, the first thing is, let's see whether the port number is correct. It's correct. Is it correct or is it incorrect in this case? The port number for the service that we are targeting, this Pro FTP.
So you're saying that 21 is the right port for this?
Yeah, I'm asking whether that's the correct port.
I don't think so.
Hello? Am I audible to you guys currently?
Yeah. Can you show us the list?
Yes, sir.
The list? Okay. Yeah. This list?
Yep.
Okay. So it's here.
2121
is the correct one in this case.
Yeah.
And that's why it helps to perform a scan for all ports. Otherwise, you would not get a lot of things that might be running. Because, see, here in this case, the situation is that there is already an FTP server running on port 21. So
Correct. They
cannot run two servers on the same port, so they are forced to use another one. But a lot of administrators, system administrators or server administrators, what they do is, instead of running services on the default ports, like for FTP default is 21, for SSH default is 22. Instead of running them on the default ports, they'll use a different port. Like maybe for 21, they'll use something like 2121 or 20,000 or whatever they want, because you know they have a lot of options. There are a total of 65,535 ports. You have lots of options for this. Now, if it's not running on the default port, it's likely that it's not going to show up for the default nmap scan, which only considers the 1,000 most common ports. So either you specify a range of ports that you want to scan, or you just scan for all ports. So if there's any services running on unusual ports, you'll also get details about those. Okay, coming back to our Metasploit. Now I need to set our port. I'll also need to set our hosts. And this is case insensitive. So if I set our port, so it doesn't matter whether I use lowercase or uppercase, it'll work here for Metasploit options. And the hosts, so set our hosts to that option, to the IP actually. So this is the IP. Now, what else do we need? User names, okay, or username file. Okay, let's provide the username file first. So set user, let's go file. SSH user.txt. Okay. This is the same file we used earlier. Set user as pass to true. So it will try the usernames as passwords itself. Let's just try running a scan with these parameters, okay, without specifying a separate password file. Try blank passwords for all users. You can try this as well. Now, what options are set? Blank passwords is correct. Password, we haven't specified a file. We haven't specified a dictionary. But so far, we've told it to try using blank passwords and the username as the password itself. It worked for SSH. Maybe it will work here as well. Let's try. Login successful already with the combination user and user. So
since we have provided stop on success as false, it keeps on
checking. Yeah. And now if you are in a hurry, then you can give this to true. So if you just find one credential and you're able to use that, you just go along with it. But if you're not under a very limited, if you don't have a time constraint or anything, then you should let it run, because different accounts may give you different files, give you access to different services or different directories on the system.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Okay, so it helps if you have more than one credential available to you. So it's telling us that it found these credentials. Now what I can do is I can try to connect. Exit. I use FTP. Not this. FTP. And the thing is, if I directly use FTP, it's just going to connect to port 21 because by default port TP. So here what I'll also need to do is specify a separate port number. So what I'll do is FTP. And of course the IP and the port, which is 2121 in this case. Okay, so it's asking me for a password. The password is user. Okay, so logged in. LS, let's see whether LS works. Opening ASCII mode for file list transfer complete. So this probably means there are no files in this particular directory. So I'm using two different options with ls now. ls-l for the long list, or sorry, not for the long list, for the list format, and -a to see the hidden files. So this is showing us the hidden files, but we are not currently going to get any use for these files. I'm just going to exit here. So we have seen quite a few different ways to get into a system with, to get into a Metasploitable system. We've used Metasploit, we've used Netcat. Okay, we can also use Hydra for doing password cracking, and we'll work using that as well. And there's a couple other services here that can also be hacked, or that can also be exploited to gain access to the system. Now, like I mentioned, there's nothing for us to do in the post exploitation phase on the system currently. So just we exploit and that's it. But for other CTFs that we do, for other machines that we try to hack into, we see that there are other things we can do there. Okay, so does anyone have any questions from today's session?
No, sir.
No.